Jimmer Hall, who did you? Falcha Goo, Ye Old Scott, the Celtic Podcast. On today's show, we'll introduce you to more simple prepositions and let you read a beginner's Gaelic book right there on the screen, page by page. And we'll do all this in Fecamich Beckin Gaelic. With Columbus Day having just passed, it made me think of the Celtic voyagers, all those who braved the rough seas in search of a better life, or plunder, or conquest, because you know that's what they did back then. And the most famous of these being St. Brendan, the Navigator. And we'll tell you about that in our Celtic History segment. Now, all Samhain season long, I will tell scary stories and interesting Celtic stories. So sit back and enjoy a Halloween treat. And I will see you on Oíche Samhain in a special podcast I'll do just that night. Today, though, I will tell you the story of Bunsworth Banshee, and tell how it does the bidding of death itself. Alright, we'll do that in everyday Celtic ways. And today we'll hear music from Corgailga, Texas, my friend Jonquil Jones's group. We'll listen to Celtic Women, and with the theme of today's show, we're going to hear a couple of songs from Celtic Voyage CD. Alright. Now, I've made the trivia a tad bit more difficult. However, if it does get too much, just let me know. So now, I have a wee bit of Irish trivia to test your knowledge to start us off. In what state in the United States did the Molly Maguires originate? Now, before we get started, I want to tell you again about a wonderful new website just for Gaelic learning. It is interactive, informative, and has tons of resources at your fingertips. It's learngaelic.net. I have learned a lot, and I think the audio parts are really helping me with my pronunciation of the Gaelic. This can be a great tool for you and me in our Gaelic learning, so take advantage of it. I know I am. Kershmaha, let's kick this thing off.
Fascal and Doris can tell you, hear you. Fascal and Doris can hear you, hear you. Fascal and Doris can tell you, hear you. Feel you, tell you. Fascal and Doris can tell you, hear you. Fascal and Doris can hear you, hear you. Fascal and Doris can tell you, hear you. Feel you, tell you. Jealous Michigan Starship, me a good clear when I need, hear you tell you. Jealous Michigan Starship, me a good clear when I need, hear you tell you. Jealous Michigan Starship, me a good clear when I need, hear you tell you. Bunny and Gorica tell you, hear you. Bunny and Gorica, hear you, hear you. Bunny and Gorica tell you, hear you. Clear when I need, hear you tell you. Bunyan and Gora can tell you, hear you. Bunyan and Gora can hear you, hear you. Bunyan and Gora can tell you, hear you. Clear when I leave, feel you, tell you. Jealous Michigan scar shook me a hug. Jealous Michigan hear you, hear you. Jealous Michigan scar shook me a hug. Clear when I leave, feel you, tell you. Jealous Michigan scar shook me a hug. Jealous Michigan hear you, hear you. Jealous Michigan scar shook me a hug. Clear when I leave, feel you, tell you. Had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic, had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic. Kalik nan kalik, Ri Kalik, Bala nan kalik, Smashal, took a kalik, had a Grisha Kalik, Verifolic. You callic, men callic, Ri Kalik, Bala nan kalik, Smashal, took a kalik, had a Grisha Kalik, Verifolic. Had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic. Had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic. Rio Colic, Ian Buyan, Risha Colic, Ave Guyan, Sturukali, Ian Curry, Peteria Curry Pollop. Rio Colic, Ian Buyan, Risha Colic, Ave Guyan, Sturukali, Ian Curry, Peteria Curry Pollop. Had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic. Had to call it Green Colic, had to call it Christianic, had to call it Guyan Buyan, Risha Buyan Verifolic. Falkatoo sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it. Falkatoo sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it. Falkatoo sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it. Ilio sail and tow we sail with it. Ilio sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it. Ilio sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it. Ilio sail and tow we sail and tow we sail with it.
Alright, that was Foscoll and Doris, Open the Door, by a good friend of mine named Jonquil Jones and her Porcheville group called Corgalga Texas, on their album entitled Foscoll and Doris as well. Now, Hot and Tom and Feckamich Bakagalik, it's time for Let's Try a Little Gaelic. Today we'll introduce you to some more simple propositions and a beginner's book, Daddy and the Car, Dagi Agus Alcar, to read right off the screen. You'll see. It'll be at the end of the Feckamich Bakagalik segment, though. So, Tasha Kishin, let's begin. Now, as in last week's Gaelic lesson, I am grouping these simple prepositions to help you recognize trends and similarities. In the second group, these prepositions all unite an indefinite noun, except those beginning, of course, with LNR, SG, SM, SP, or ST. You see, this is a kind of a common thing that occurs. You've seen that a few times already. They all combine with the singular definite article on. The definite article on loses its initial A, and so like an example would be vo. Normally, you'd have the on, whatever. It loses that A and becomes von, B-H-O-N. So, and here's an example of how it doesn't do, how it was last time in the first group. Gung Shu, without a dog. Gung Inku, without the dog. Now, in all the following prepositions, when referring to the book or the house, the preposition does change. It kind of absorbs the on, making vo into von, yen, den into yen, and etc. So, from the book equals, is, so from the book is equals von lar. Vo and ja, it is seen two ways. Vo and o, and ja and do. So, we'll get started. The vo, from, vo lar, from a book. Von lar, from the book. J, of, or off. Jehenia, of fire. gentania of the fire. Yah equals two. Yahai to a house. Yantai to the house. Fo is under or below. Fo hunsir, under a plate. Fon trunsir, under the plate. Mu, it's about. Muyelov, about a pitcher. Munjelov, about the pitcher. Ro is before. Rohuist, before an accident. Run tuist, before the accident. Tro, through. Tro horse, through a door. Trondoris, through the door. Now sometimes den often appears as yen, D-H-E-N, in both the spoken and the written language. Sometimes these little things, these little idiomatic things happen because the language is so old and was once just a spoken language. Now I'm going to give you six exercise sentences to do. Hamyadolian Tai, number one. Harula Khoshik Trondoris, number two. Nakel Moon Husho, three. Avelu Yansigig von Lar, four. Bimi Adol Ro Jamarsh, five. And Ha Indunya von Tai, six. And we'll give you a little bit of vocabulary too, some of the words that you've seen brought up today. Adol, going. Akashic, walking. Ku, dog. Yantigig, learning. Jamarsh, Tuesday. Dunya, person or man. And now we're going to put two different children's books up on the screen. The first one I will read, and you'll hear me reading it. The second one I'm going to put up on the screen won't have any audio to it, so you can stop and start as you go through the book and translate it and figure out what it says. Hopefully you'll just be able to read it as it goes. But if you don't, if you need to stop, I give you about 10 seconds per page. So if you need to, you can just stop at any time and just look in your dictionaries and find out what you need to find out to figure out what it says. All right, but it's good practice learning reading and comprehension of the Gaelic language. Na Cearrachan Uaire. Uair sin Cearrachan Uaire. Ha Ceathair Déag an an Gcuilleadh. Hanek iat eravata. Hurshin iat yan shane tai. Va ekel ora agas ru iat erfid an acha. Anathla ruk nakerakan ura. Urshin u andunya. Akan ursin. Va iat abre. Ansa hula acha. Va te abre, astai ansan chimler. Ruk I keher urin an shin. Va niet ak te ella ansa hulak. Va ya abre anam boyak. Chormisha molav. Shias yan niet ha ro fias akam icher guro fentikin an lashk mi molav agas suath mi kopak riha ersin and takrasht a horsh atsha ur mi da u anan un niet agas in keher Anan niet ela, hashen shia. Shinne.
Shida wa moy, shida wa moy, shida wa moy, kalach nargat. Shida wa moy, wala rishpor, iskarek shikosh te hevorach hasharigat. Ba beka san steam, gajir da nilang, sarai galdim, ba shira ni kavrani. Chach shin shtur, nein ora rakol, sechenoch shishul, kalach nargat. Shida wa moy, shida wa moy, shida wa moy. Narigat shida ba moy wal rishpor is karak shikosh te bar khasharga masn to boz masn to boz better in mal sho tosan na boz ma to she o ke stolak shin tarige shida ba moy shida ba moy shida ba moy kalak narige
That was Celtic Women with Sido Famo, the Wealthy Widow. I'm not 100% sure I pronounced that right, but I don't know. Now we will delve into the rich history of our Celtic past in our segment, The Celtic History Break. Today's topic is Celtic Voyagers, all those that sought out after lands, and with the most of them, most famous one of them being St. Brendan the Navigator. All right, let's get to it. All right. Now, like I said in the introduction, with Columbus Day coming up, this is what brought this to my mind. And, you know, the Celtic voyagers, they were people at the end of the earth, but they liked to travel. They've been forced to travel by the Roman conquest of Europe, which pushed the Celts further and further to the west. And they were pushed basically to the furthest parts of the known world. Now the Romans, they never reached Ireland, a place they considered to be at the precipice of the edge of the world. To the Celts who settled Ireland, however, their island was perceived as just one of many lands for suitable habitation. their original migration to the island had involved not only a seafaring technology, but an adventurous awareness that there were other worlds beyond their own to explore. As a people, they had wandered a long way by land and sea from the Celtic heartland in continental Europe. It seemed that curiosity and the love for travel were in the Celtic blood. Now, from 3rd century AD, Irish seafaring chieftains and their warriors were defying the Romans who had conquered Britain, and they were defying the Romans to raid Western Britain. The 16-year-old Romanized Celt from Britain who would later become St. Patrick was just one of many Irish slaves, slaves that the Irish seafaring raiders took from Britain to work on Irish farms. St. Patrick wasn't Irish, he was actually English. But the Irish who sailed to Britain to form permanent settlements such as Dyfed in Wales, which began a royal dynasty which lasted for over 5 centuries. Dyfed is today still proudly named after the Irish kingdom. Another Irish kingdom that was set up in Wales was Brecknock. Now, from about the 4th century AD, the Irish Celts, known to the Romans as the Scoti, invaded Britain's far north, where they established permanent settlements, eventually founding a kingdom there in the 5th century called Dalreda. The Irish Scoti ultimately gave their name to part of Britain now known as Scotland. Today, many people in Scotland continue to speak Gaelic, the Irish branch of the Celtic language, and to live in a country named after the Irish people who settled it. The earliest Latin name for Ireland was Scotia, which was eventually replaced with the Latin name Hibernia. For centuries, the word Scotus, as part of a person's name, denoted being Irish or of Irish ancestry. Now, when somebody would present themselves, they would use that as kind of like a middle name, saying like this Latin-speaking Irish monk who was favored in the royal court of Charlemagne. His name was Johannes Scotus Arugina, and that let everybody know that he was from Ireland. So that's kind of interesting. Now, the voyage of St. Brendan, like I said, this is the most famous of all the Celtic voyagers. A 7th century AD Latin text from Irish monastery describes the 6th century journey of a Celtic monk explorer, St. Brendan, who sailed from Ireland into the unknown reaches of the Atlantic in search of the land of promise of the saints. The saga, known as Navigatio Sancti Brennan Abbatis, Voyage of St. Brennan the Abbot, describes the St. Brennan with a crew of fellow monks reaching and returning from a distant land which some now believe to have been America. The description of the 7-year-long voyage included references to what may have been whales, volcanic eruptions, which do occur in Iceland, and icebergs, which are commonly found floating southward with the Labrador Current along the coast of North America. Along the distant land discovered by St. Brendan the Navigator has never really actually been verified as America. There is evidence in New England, though, that Celtic visitors constructed megaliths there well before Columbus crossed the Atlantic in 1492. The Navigatio was eventually translated in continental European monasteries by Irish monks from Latin into other languages, so later explorers, including Columbus and others, were influenced by it. Now, St. Brendan, who founded Clontarf Monastery in Ireland's County Galway, explored the Atlantic 4 centuries before the Vikings may have reached North America, and about 9 centuries before Columbus. Galway is situated in Ireland's rugged west coast, the perfect departure point for Atlantic explorers. We know that the Celts were great boat builders, based on the discovery of the 60-foot masted Celtic vessel lying at the bottom of Lake Neuchâtel. Now Caesar, just Julius Caesar it is, he wrote admiringly of the Celtic Breton Veneti seafarers whose coast, he said, lies exposed to the violence of the open sea. He used Celtic-built ships to transport a Roman army of 10,000 men in 55 BC to invade Britain, as a matter of fact. And it is known if he sought the protection of Menenan, the Celtic god of the sea, though. Strabo mentioned the force of the Atlantic winds in describing the seaworthy oak-built design of Celtic ships. No one knows precisely from where in Europe the Celts came to Ireland. One possibility is that they sailed from Brittany in their timber sailing vessels, which have been described as up to 150 feet long, with a mast beam of 16 feet. The Mayflower, which carried the pilgrims from England to America in 1620, in contrast, was only about 90 feet long. So that's kind of impressive. Now, not a whole lot is known about St. Brendan's voyage, but recently, using Irish technology and the materials, only the materials of the 6th century, a 36-foot replica of St. Brendan's skin-covered boat was constructed and successfully sailed from Ireland to North America by Timothy Severin and his crew. It's a Celtic Veneti-type craft designed by Strabo. And it could have possibly been the same type that St. Brendan used. There's a lot of talk about him using what is called a curragh, but those are so small, they're technically designed for just inner waterways and relatively calm water. Something that small would not have made a trip across the Atlantic. But I think this is fascinating that they actually built one and sailed it, and it worked. So, maybe we shouldn't be celebrating St. Columbus Day. Columbus Day, we should be celebrating St. Brendan Day. All right, that's it for your Celtic History Break. That was Rose and Heather from the Celtic Voyage album. Of course, sticking with our Celtic Voyager theme there today. Now it's time for Everyday Celtic Ways, a look into how our Celtic heritage is still very much a part of our everyday lives. During the rest of this month, until Halloween, or Oich Samhain, I will be telling scary Celtic stories for the Samhain season. You can relive last week's The Monster of Glamis Castle, or Mary Culhane in my August 31st podcast, or Angeli Dhu in my September 21st podcast. This week, though, I'm going to tell you about Bunsworth's Banshee. And like all good stories, they have one foot in the truth and the other, well, in good storytelling. And Bunsworth's Banshee. The story of the Reverend Charles Bunsworth and the Banshee took place in Butte Vant, County Cork, Ireland, in the 18th century. The Reverend was a much respected man in the area and admired as an accomplished harpist. When he became ill, local people became very concerned. This was a concern that was heightened not by the immediate prognosis of his illness, which was not really thought to be terminal, but the strange events that took place in the area prior to his demise. A servant of the household reported to the concerned family of the Reverend one morning that he had heard the wailing of a banshee. He described how the woman had wailed and moaned and clapped her hands in despair, repeating the Reverend's name over and over and over again. Local people know that this could only mean one thing, for the banshee was known to all as the lone female figure who cries out in agonizing despair to herald in an impending death. She is cursed by death itself to carry out her awful otherworldly task. Irish people have known her for a long time. Have known her as Banshee or Banshee, also known in other parts of the Celtic world. The Banshee is seen as a messenger from the other world, which is both the home of the gods and the realm of the dead. The Banshee can take many forms, as she can be old, young, beautiful, or ugly. She is often heard but not seen, and her lonesome cry instills fear in those that hear it. An eerie silence forewarns of her piercing cry. From the smallest insect to the fiercest beast, the woods and forest fall silent and none make a sound to disturb the banshee when she cries, for none want her mournful cry turned upon them. Now the family of the Reverend Bunsworth, being a devout Christian, dismissed the talk of the servant as mere superstition, for the Reverend was a man of God, and not such ancient dribble as this. Besides, his health had appeared to be improving. However, this was before the appearance of the banshee. Now his condition rapidly declined, and now on the night before his condition took a fatal turn, the servants tried anything to help. Reverend Bunsworth had been moved downstairs so he could sleep in peace, for something kept making noises at the sill of his windows, and the mournful winds blowing through the trees and the forest only reminded him of the dreadful omen that was rumored in less civilized homes. Even downstairs outside of his room's window, a moaning and clapping had been heard. When servants had gone outside to investigate, it was found that a rose bush close to the window had been partially trampled, as if somebody had made a bed of it. There was no sign of anybody that could have made the noises or trampled the bush, which sent fear into the servants of the household. Those who had remained inside the house once again heard the sound of moaning and clapping coming from all different areas around the house, sending them into a flurry to discover where the noises emanated from. But nothing came from any search. It seemed as if the noises came from everywhere and from nowhere at the same time, as if emanating from your very soul. As the night wore on, the Reverend's health worsened. But the howling had only gotten worse. The eerie sounds filled the tall ceilings and walls of the old house. The servants retreated to their quarters, locked their doors, and did all they could to avoid the fate of the Banshee, inadvertently leaving poor sick Reverend Bunworth to face his awful fate. By morning, the noises had stopped, but it was evident that they had taken their toll on poor Reverend. And by the time that dawn broke through the stained glass window at the side of his bed, he had expired as well. Many said this was inevitable, that it had been predicted by the arrival of the Banshee. This is what is so troubling about the Banshee, though. Its ill curse comes on without notice. It runs its course and cannot be subsided by any bribe or offering. Normal people, druids, witches, and demons alike fear the Banshee for this very reason. None are immune to its cry, for it is the cry of death. So if you hear the anguished cry of the Banshee, pray that she is not coming for you. The end. Well, that's it for today's show. I hope you liked it. I'm trying to keep it interesting, informative, and fun. For me, anytime you can infuse something Celtic into your day, that's a good day. I can't leave without giving you the answer to the trivia question today, which is Pennsylvania. Now, there's a great old movie starring Sean Connery called The Molly Maguires, and it tells the plight of these men working in horrible conditions in Pennsylvania's coal mines and how they fought their oppressors. It's a really good movie. You should try and check it out. All right. Now, I want to remind you guys about LearnGaelic.net. It's a great resource. Check it out. And also want you to check out our YouTube channel, Ye Old Scott. We got Celtic Christmas videos, some mood music for the holidays on there. We got some stories to sit down and listen to. And, of course, we've got, you know, months and months of podcasts to listen to. Also, I have some collection of Speaking Our Language and Macher and a whole bunch of other Irish and Scottish and Celtic videos on there. So come to the site, enjoy it, and have fun. Martian Leaving Drazda, bye for now. Now I'm going to leave you with this song called The Butterfly from the Celtic Voyage album.